Hello, today we are going to discuss about pulse and digital circuits and introduction to this course. We are dealing with JNTUH syllabus. So pulse and digital circuits, basically if you are going with any circuit, that is network in our terms, any electrical network will be divided into two cases. One is linear network, the other is non-linear network. The meaning of linear network: linear network is a network which consisting of only linear elements. Examples of linear elements are resistance, inductance and capacitance, okay, or any combination of that one. If a circuit is made up of resistors or inductors or capacitors or any combination, either RL or RC or RLC, then the circuit is called as linear network, okay. Whereas non-linear network: in a linear network, if you insert any non-linear element, then the circuit will become non-linear network. You must insert at least one non-linear element should be inserted into linear network, then that is called as non-linear network. So non-linear network will also consisting of RLC, okay, a combination of anything. Along with them, definitely at least one non-linear element must be present. What are the examples of non-linear element? Non-linear element examples are diodes, BJT, FET, UJT, SCR, TRIAC, DIAC, etc. So most of the active devices are non-linear networks. Next, if you are coming for the linear network, examples are simple RC circuit, simple RL circuit, simple RLC circuit, or any complex combination of RLC. All will be treated as linear networks. The basic function of linearity means it must obey superposition and homogeneity principles. Okay. So superposition and homogeneity principles are going to be valid for voltages and currents across R, L and C. So these three elements are treated as linear elements. So first we will go with linear network, later we will come across non-linear network. Okay. So let us assume we are going with a linear network. This linear network may be any of the combination described above. It may be simple RC, simple RL, simple RLC, or any complex combination. If you apply any sinusoidal input signal for a linear network, the output is also of sinusoidal in nature. So the response of linear network for a sinusoidal input is always sinusoidal in output, but there may be a change in the amplitude, that is the amplitude of the signal may be deteriorated or decreases, and there may be some phase shift exists between output and input. Except for these two changes, okay, the output wave shape is exactly same as input wave shape. That means sinusoidal input will maintain same sinusoidal at the output side. That means input wave shape is preserved at the output of linear network if the input signal is sinusoidal. But only the two changes is nothing but either amplitude of the signal may be changes, as well as there may be a phase shift occurs between input and output. This is first one, amplitude of the signal may be changes and there may be a phase shift occurs between input and output wave shape. What happens for a linear network if you apply non-sinusoidal signal? First you will see what are the examples of non-sinusoidal signals. Generally we come across step signal. Examples are unit step or some old step, step signal, pulse signal, ramp signal, square wave and exponential, impulse, all other signals except for, that is other than sinusoidal, are going to be treated as non-sinusoidal. Important of non-sinusoidal signals are going to be, these are the five signals we will consider in this subject: step, pulse, square, ramp and exponential waveforms. If you apply any of this waveform as input for a linear network, then output doesn't maintain the input shape. Definitely output gets altered. So the output wave shape is not same as input wave shape when a non-sinusoidal signal is applied to linear network. This study how the input wave shape is going to get changes at the outputs. Okay, the study is, this is related to the process of studying how the input wave shape of non-sinusoidal signal when it is transmitted through a linear network. Okay, it's going to get changed. That study is going to be treated as linear wave shaping. First unit name under pulse and digital circuits is linear wave shaping. Linear wave shaping is a study related to changes in the output wave shape when a non-sinusoidal signal is transmitted through a linear network. So this is the basic definition of linear wave shaping, and this is the first unit. Unit 1. And in this unit we are going to study two things. One is we are confirming the statement what we have made for a sinusoidal input. So first we will go for the response of linear network. If you apply sinusoidal input, we are going to prove that the output wave shape is preserved, but only changes in the amplitude, and there may be a phase shift occurs between output and input. Later we will go for response of linear network for each non-sinusoidal signal. So first we will start with step signal. If you apply it for a linear network, what happens at the output side, how it is going to be get changes. Next pulse input, next square wave input, ramp input, exponential input. Okay, like this, all these five steps, phi is going to be applied for a RC circuit as well as RL circuit. Simply RLC circuit also will apply. So what will be the response of each and every circuit when that is applied with a non-sinusoidal inputs? That's what we are going to study in linear wave shaping. Next, come to non-linear network. Already we know non-linear network is nothing but it's going to be linear if any non-linear element, if at least one non-linear element is present in any circuit, that circuit is going to be called as non-linear network. At least one non-linear element should be present in a network. Okay, so if it is not present, that is called as linear network. If at least one non-linear element is not present, that means the circuit is consisting of all linear elements only. So in a linear network, if you put a non-linear element at that time, that will become non-linear circuit or non-linear network. Non-linearity means there is a non-linear relationship between voltage and current across the device. Of that device, if you check about voltage and current relationship, that is not linear. Such type of devices are called as non-linear devices or non-linear elements. For a diode, if you observe, diode is a non-linear element. How can we say that one? Because the current equation for a diode is indicated like this. I is equal to I naught into e power v by eta vt minus 1. This is what diode equation, where the current and voltage are exponentially related. That's why it is non-linear. And if you come for the BJT, BJT is also in the same, BJT consisting of two diodes in back-to-back connection. So there also IC is equal to beta times of IB plus 1 plus beta times of IC naught. We know this equation. This is with respect to the currents, but if you observe, IC is always depends on function of IB, but IB base current. Base current is nothing but current flowing through base emitter junction, which is function of V input. This is with respect to the diode operation, diode forward bias. Again, it is exponential. So output current and input current, even though it looks like linearly related, but input current is going to be exponentially related to input voltage for a transistor. So output current is indirectly related to exponentially with input voltage. So BJT is also non-linear element. Similarly FET, if you observe the current voltage equation, you can say that one, it is non-linear element. That the relationship between current and voltage is not linear, so that it will be treated as nonlinear element. Okay. So now what happens if you apply for a nonlinear element, a sinusoidal input? That's what we are going to study in the unit 2, which is called as nonlinear wave shaping. In second unit, we are going to study nonlinear wave shaping. Unit 2, non-linear wave shaping. So here we observe that one, for a non-linear network, if you apply sinusoidal input, the output is not sinusoidal input. Output is not sinusoidal. So sinusoidal input, if you apply for a nonlinear network, then definitely output is not same as sinusoidal. It's going to change. How it is going to change? If you are going to study about these changes in the output wave shape, when a sinusoidal input is passing through a nonlinear network, that is called as nonlinear wave shaping. This we are going to study. So we are applying not only sinusoidal input, we can apply any periodic waveform. Okay, like square waveform, like triangular waveform, anything can be applied to nonlinear network where the output is not maintained the same shape as input. Okay, how it is going to be get changes based on the operation of nonlinear elements inside. So first of all, we should know the operation of nonlinear element so that we can define the output wave shape for the given input. That's what we are going to study in the second unit. And third unit, we are going to study about switching characteristics. Switching characteristics of diode and transistor. Transistor means here BJT, as well as we are going to study about sampling gates. So these two are comes under unit 3. We are going for the two active devices. One is diode, the other is BJT. For them, we are going to see the switching characteristics. Already we know that one, a diode can act as a switch. Diode can act as switch, whereas BJT can act as amplifier as well as switch. So already we studied very much about BJT acting as amplifier in previous two semesters. In EDC subject we have studied, in ECA subject also we have studied. In EDC we have seen how a transistor is acting as an amplifier. Directly if you connect input signal to a transistor, it won't amplify. First the transistor must be in active region. For that one we require biasing. After biasing, proper biasing. Biasing means, biasing is a process of keeping the transistor in one of the regions. It may be active or cutoff or saturation. So by applying some external voltages and external resistors, we are going to keep the transistor in active region where it can act as amplifier. And after that one, if it is acting as amplifier, how to model, how to calculate the gain provided for the input signal, voltage gain, current gain, input impedance, output impedance, all these things we have studied with the help of small signal analysis. So we studied, and lot of that is types of amplifiers also have studied, different types of amplifiers, tuned amplifiers, feedback amplifiers, power amplifiers, etc. So we have already much studied about the amplifier. We are not going to study again. So in this pulse and digital circuits lecture, we are going to study about switching characteristics of transistors, which you have not studied previously. So how a transistor is acting as a switch, and what are the different types, different times are going to be present whenever it is coming from on to off, whenever it is coming from off to on. How to define those different switching times, what is the relationship between them, that we are going to study with graphically. So these are the things we are going to study: diode switching times as well as transistor switching times. Next we are coming into sampling gates. Already we have studied in STLD, switching theory and logic design, we have studied about multiplexers. It is simply called as MUX. Okay. So generally what is the function of MUX? Function of MUX is going to be like this: 2 power n to 1 MUX it will be called. That means it consisting of n select lines, and there will be 2 power n inputs. 2 power n inputs, but only one output it will have. So out of these 2 power n inputs, one can be selected with the help of n select lines, and that will be connected to one output. So since the output is only a single line that can be connected to any one of the single line presented input, so one will be selected with the help of select lines. But always, if you observe, the inputs are going to be digital in nature. Either you may be connecting logic 1 or logic 0. So this multiplexer what you have studied in STLD is called as digital multiplexer. Now we are going to study about analog multiplexer. Analog MUX. Analog MUX is nothing but the other name is sampling gate. Sampling gate is also called as analog multiplexer. So here also you will have select lines. Select lines will be present, and inputs you are going to apply. Here the inputs are going to be input waveforms. Different input waveforms you are applying, not the digits, either logic 0 or logic 1. Here we are going to apply input waveforms, that is analog inputs you are going to apply. With the help of select line you are going to select one out of this one, and it will be connected to the output side. So output is also of waveform. This is what analog multiplexer, how we can do this one. Okay, that we are going to study under sampling gates. And how do we implement sampling gates using only single diode, using two diodes. Okay, how do you get bidirectional sampling gates? Okay, how do you improve the performance, and how do you implement the same functionality with the help of transistors? Okay, what are the different types of circuits? That we are going to study under sampling gates. So this is about unit 3. Next, we are going to study about unit 4. Unit 4 is related to applications of, from this one, unit 4 onwards, it is going to be related to applications of diodes and transistors. Applications of diodes and transistors are from unit 4. Unit 4 and 5 are going to be related to applications of diodes and transistors. So what are the different types of applications we have? Okay, one is multivibrators. Multivibrators will generate, there are three different types of multivibrators. One is bistable multivibrator, a stable multivibrator, and monostable multivibrator. Bistable multivibrator acts as flip-flop, that is memory element. Either it may be storing one of the information, Q1 on, Q2 off, or Q1 off, Q2 on. So simply it has two stable states, that's why each stable state is going to be treated as it is memorizing that state. It will be stable in that state permanently. So if you want to change, you must apply a trigger. Since it has two stable states, and stable means permanent, so it remembers that value permanently. Whenever it is remembering a value permanently, we can assume that when it is memorized that value, that is it has stored that value inside, so it can has the characteristic of flip-flop. Bistable multivibrator can act as flip-flop. Next, unstable multivibrator. A stable multivibrator will have two temporary states. So it is generating a square waveform. It is generating either square or rectangular waveforms are going to be generated. A square or rectangular waveform can be generated with the help of a stable multivibrator. That's why a stable multivibrator is called as free running oscillator, which generates either square or rectangular waveform depending on the duty cycle. Okay, so free running oscillator, a stable multivibrator, and monostable multivibrator is going to be called as pulse width generator. Pulse width generator, it has one stable state and one temporary state. Okay, so it can be used as pulse width generator. These are all applications of diodes and transistors. Here we are going to use transistors in multivibrators, okay, and with the help of diodes we are going to improve the performance of multivibrators. That is what we are going to study. And one more thing also we are going to study, which is Smith trigger. Smith trigger is another variation of bistable multivibrator. Smith trigger is going to be improved version, that is another variation of bistable multivibrator. That also we are going to study. Smith trigger generally converts sinusoidal to square waveform. If the input given for a Smith trigger is sinusoidal, okay, then the output is square waveform based on some condition. Okay, the magnitude peak to peak value of input signal should be greater than the hysteresis range of Smith trigger, then the output is exactly square waveform. Okay, and next application is time based generators. Time based generators, as we can say from this name, it is going to generate a waveform whose x axis, that is base axis, is time. We are going to generate a waveform from a circuit whose base axis, that means x axis, is going to be time, where the y axis can be either voltage or current. If the y axis is voltage, then it is voltage time based generators. If the y axis is current, then it is current time based generators. So we have two different types of time based generators. One is voltage time based generator and the other is current time based generator. And time based generators are simply output voltage or current are going to be increases linearly with respect to time. As time increases, voltage or current should vary linearly like this. Then it is called as time based generators. Not only with positive slope, it can also with negative slope. This can also with negative slope also. In both cases, it will be treated as time based generators. Okay, the variation must be linear with respect to time. Y axis variation must be linear with respect to time, either it may be in positive slope or it may be in the negative slope. Different time based generators we are going to study. Okay, advantages and disadvantages of each and every circuit. So those are the things we are going to study. This is second application of diodes and transistors. These two we are going to study in unit 4. Next application, unit 5, logic gates. Logic gate families. Okay, so where logic gates are going to be manufactured with the help of different techniques, based on that one they are categorized as different families. It may be RTL family or DTL family, TTL family, CMOS, NMOS, okay, etc. We are going with ECL, emitter coupled logic. RTL means resistor transistor logic, DTL means diode transistor logic, TTL transistor transistor logic, CMOS complementary metal oxide semiconductor, ECL emitter coupled logic. So many others are going to be there. So these different logic families we are going to study. Okay, and we know that one, if you are going with logic gates, already have studied that one. If you are considering AND and OR and NOT gates, with the help of AND OR NOT gates you can build a complete circuit. That's why this is going to be treated as complete set. If you have a sufficient number of AND OR NOT gates, then you can build any combinational circuits. That's why the combination of these three are going to be treated as complete set. Otherwise, if you have a sufficient number of NAND gates, then you can build any combinational circuits. Otherwise, if you have a sufficient number of NOR gates, then you can build any combinational circuit can be realized with the help of either only NAND gates or only NOR gates, or if you have a sufficient number of AND or inverter NOT gates. So that's why only because of this characteristic, okay, they will be treated as NAND and NOR gates are going to be called as universal gates. Universal gates. So we are going to study how a NAND gate or NOR gate is going to be manufactured, how it is fabricated using different circuit technologies: RTL, DTL, TTL, CMOS, ECL, which is the basic logic gate. Okay, which universal gate is going to maintain, which universal gate is fabricated from each technology. If it is RTL, which gate is going to fabricated, if it is DTL, if it is TTL, CMOS, ECL. Okay, that we are going to study. These are all applications of transistor, where the transistor is now acting as a switch. And one more thing is extension to multivibrators. Extension to either monostable multivibrator or a stable multivibrator, or also you can know that one, UJT relaxation oscillator. UJT relaxation oscillator. Okay, or any time-based generators. Time-based generators, extension to these things. That is, already we have studied about this one. With the help of this one, we are going to study one concept as synchronization and frequency division. Synchronization and frequency division. This concept we are going to study. That means if you require, okay, more than one waveform, and those waveforms all must be in synchronous while it is working in the circuit. How to get that synchronization between two waveforms? If they have both frequencies are same, then it is called as one-to-one frequency synchronization. One-to-one synchronization means you are going to get the synchronization between two or more frequency components, but all are going to be having the same frequency. One-to-many synchronization, that means, okay, you are going to get the synchronization between two or more frequencies. Each is going to be not equal to the other, but it may be multiples of the first one. Okay, so let us assume we are going with three things. F1, F2, F3 are going to be three different frequencies which are generated from either MMV, AMV, UJT or time-based generators. Then if all are going to be same, that is called as one-to-one synchronization. Otherwise, F1 is equal to 2F2, okay, and that may be equal to 4F3 or 5F3, then it is going to be treated as one-to-many synchronization. How to achieve these things? That we are going to study. Okay, this concept is also called as frequency division, because F3 is equal to F1 by 4. If you divide the frequency F1 by 4 times, you will get the F3. If F1 is equal to 2F2, F2 is equal to written as F1 by 2. How to divide the frequency synchronously? If you have a larger frequency, how to get the reduced frequency? How to achieve frequency division? These things we are going to study. Okay, this third one and fourth one are going to be comes under unit 5. So these are the different units which we are going to study in pulse and digital circuits. So look at this introduction. Pulse and digital circuits, unit 1 is linear wave shaping. Already you have seen linear wave shaping is a process of studying the alteration or changes in the output waveform when a non-sinusoidal input is passing through, transmitted through a linear network. So Here we are going to study high pass and low pass RC circuits and the responses for the different inputs, sinusoidal as well as non-sinusoidal inputs. Examples of non-sinusoidal inputs we are going to study step, pulse, square and ramp inputs. We are not going to study exponential. High pass RC network as differentiator and low pass RC circuit as integrator. The characteristic of high pass RC circuit, it can act as differentiator based on one condition. And low pass circuit can act as integrator based on the condition of time constant. How you are going to get the time constant, we will derive that. Okay. And attenuators, its applications, RL and RLC circuits also we are going to study for different inputs. Next one is second unit. Already we have seen nonlinear wave shaping. Examples of nonlinear wave shaping are nothing but clippers and clampers. So clippers and clampers, comparators, okay, their operations, effects, okay. And third unit is switching characteristics of devices, where the diode is acting as a switch, and the diode characteristics, diode switching times we are going to study. Next we are coming towards transistor. How a transistor acts as a switch, first we will see, even though we have studied previously. Next, okay, how it will behave in saturation, active and cutoff regions, temperature variation of parameters, okay, that too mainly in saturation, because in cutoff there will be no current, in saturation current flows. So how the parameters related to saturation region are going to be changes if you increase the temperature or if you decrease the temperature, that we are going to study in this one. And transistor switching times, how much time does it take a transistor to switch on from on to off or off to on, that is switching on time, switching off times, how they will be divided, what are the different switching times associated with on to off as well as off to on. Okay, and the last one we are going to study is SCR switch, silicon controlled switch circuits. Already we have studied SCR, related to SCR in EDC, electronic devices and circuits, and now we find the applications of SCR as a switch. Next, sampling gates. Sampling gates are nothing but analog multiplexers. Already we have seen how you are going to get that multiplexer operation for analog signals. What are the different types of circuits, advantages and disadvantages, that we are going to study. And fifth one is multi-vibrators, okay, and time-based generators. Already we discussed this one. Different circuits and advantages and disadvantages we are going to study. The last one is nothing but synchronization and frequency division. Okay. As well as realization of logic gates using diodes and transistors, that we are going to study. And the textbooks which we are going to refer is PDC by Millman and Taub. PDC by Millman and Taub, that is first book. Second book which we are interested is Pulse and Digital Circuits by Anand Kumar. Pulse and Digital Circuits by Anand Kumar is preferred, and Pulse and Digital Circuits by Millman and Taub. Students can go through Pulse and Digital Circuits by Anand Kumar, whereas I am going to refer both the things, Millman and Taub as well as PDC by Anand Kumar. Okay, so today we will stop about the introduction, and next class we are going to discuss about response of RC circuit. First we will study about low pass RC circuit. Okay, response of low pass RC circuit for a sinusoidal input, we are going to prove the output wave shape is preserved, only the amplitude is going to get changed, as well as there may be existing a phase shift between output and input, that we will prove in the next class. Thank you.